involved are you in communications with either Health Canada or the CDC? Is that part of the day-to-day due diligence?
Yes, it is.
Could they, in theory, just say, you cannot allow spectators into your arenas?
We're not going to speculate as to what they could or couldn't say. We're aware of what's happening in other places in the world, and we understand that things may evolve or change, and we also understand that we're going to have to react to it in a professional and timely and sensible basis. But I don't think, as we sit here today, people should get too far ahead of themselves in terms of how they either react to this or report this. Let's see how it all evolves.
Those two bodies generally don't legislate things, they make recommendations. But they are the experts in the field, so you tend to follow their recommendations, certainly.
And it may vary by location. It may be that a jurisdiction, either in Canada or the United States, other than federally, may make its own determination as to what needs to be done, and we'll have to deal with it, which is why speculation, when you're dealing with something like this, isn't particularly helpful. However, we're staying on top of it, which is what you have to do. And we're aware of all the possible alternatives and how we may have to deal with any of those alternatives once something happens that we have to react to. If something happens that we have to react to.
And that is what both organizations are doing. They're really pushing it down to the local health authorities because it's a kind of a local outbreak kind of condition that they would be concerned about. So they're recommending Reliance get in contact with your local health community, understand what's going on in your local community, and respond appropriately.
And as you would imagine, we're in constant communication with our clubs, not just in the general managers meeting, but at all of the levels as well.
Just a little bit more follow-up. In talking to some of the general managers, obviously they have employees and scouting staffs that get deployed all over the world. It sounds like it's time for the clubs for right now to make the determination on where their staff can and can't go. Is there a point where the league takes some sort of charge of those sorts of orders as well?
Well, we have our own policy at the league office in terms of travel and quarantining. The clubs are aware of that, and at least for the time being, they know what we're doing. They're free to adopt it, but it's going to be an individual club-by-club decision for the time being.
And what would be the policy that you guys have for international travel right now for your employees? What's the recommendation?
Basically, if you're traveling we've barred all travel outside of North America for business purposes. People, as a personal level, or people in their households, are still free to do what they want to do. If you go to a place that's on the list of countries that have an issue, or while you're there, the country comes on the list, and when you come back, we want you quarantined out of the office for 2 weeks until we can see if symptoms develop. And the clubs know that that's what we're doing. They've been advised, and they're free to adapt as much or as little of that policy, at least for the time being, as possible.
And is that based on a recommendation from the CDC
or
from the
body? That's being fully informed as to the state of medicine and what is available to know about the coronavirus.
Further to that, how has it affected NHL Central Scouting? Those scouts being affected, the ones that are in Europe?
The ones that are in Europe are staying in Europe unless they come back and then they have to be quarantined for 2 weeks to see if any symptoms arise.
Are there any directives to teams about cleanliness or anything?
Yeah, all the stuff that you're reading in the newspapers and that the CDC's promulgating, we're promulgating to the clubs as well.
The NBA went as far as...
But this is like we're going around the table.
The NBA went as far as Sundays to issue a memo suggesting limiting high fives even in the locker room, not taking Sharpies from fans, not taking jerseys from fans. Has the NHL offered a similar directive to that?
We're advising the clubs as to what's appropriate. When it comes to that level of detail, leagues will do what they think appropriate and necessary under the circumstances. Our clubs at the medical level, the training level, and the player level pretty informed as to what is wise and prudent conduct under the circumstances. We're going over here, or the pressure's on that one.
What did you think when David Aaron stepped on the ice a weeks ago? Or what was going through your mind?
The first thing was, gee, this doesn't happen very often. I think it was the second time in 50 years. It was intriguing, to say the least, especially after he let the first two shots in. What was, to me, more remarkable was how he settled down and how Carolina played the third period. It kind of looked like they really upped their game to really protect the situation. It got a great deal of attention. It, for those of you old enough to remember, it was a real Walter Mitty moment. It's sports, I suppose, at its most interesting and its best.
Were you worried, though, after the first two shots?
I worry about everything, and I don't overreact to anything. Yes, Pierre.
Salary cap projection to the managers today, and I'm so happy to share that with us.
Mr. Daly, feel free.
So, yes, we did. Based on current projections, we told the managers we expected the cap for next year would be somewhere between 84 and 88.2 million, and that depends on the results of our negotiation with the Players Association is with respect to what inflator, if any, we apply to the numbers in the formula. I also reported that part of our discussions with the Players Association on the CBA front has been to see if we can come up with a formula that can provide a little more predictability to the clubs on a more advanced basis than currently is the case. Typically over the last several years, really probably since we initiated the CBA, we haven't been able to give them a cap number until late June, in and around the time of the draft. Hopefully at some point in the future, we'll have a mechanism that, allows them to have that information soon.
And keep in mind that because the cap and the escrow are inextricably connected, if the concern is keeping the escrow down, then we've got to focus on the cap in that light. Yes?
Just to clarify, is the 84 with 0%?
Yes.
88.5 with
5%. Correct.
So it's anywhere.
It's 88.2, but 5%.
Anybody else?
Just quickly on the puck and player tracking. Obviously, you're starting this in the playoffs. From everything that you've seen, are you really confident that the system is in place and working really well, and no major concerns?
The system works. It's been tested. But what you're really focusing on is the puck, and the puck has been extensively tested. It's been extensively used, and anybody suggesting that somehow that could be an issue. It's pure speculation, misguided speculation, and probably didn't pay attention in the presentation yesterday.
I wasn't fully asking.
So you'll take your shot back, but that's okay. I get it.
Fair.
Okay. I wasn't referring to you about the shot. It was Frank, but that's okay.
I read it.
Yeah, no, me too. Actually, I didn't read it. Somebody told me, but that's okay. It's fine. Listen, every now and then we get complaints about ice conditions, and that won't change in the playoffs because it gets warmer and some buildings have issues. The puck has been really extensively tested. There's no difference in the physical characteristics and how it performs.
But with the cap, you want to get them the information sooner if possible with the new mechanism. When do they want it? What's ideal?
They haven't, other than get it to us as soon as you can possibly get it to us. We haven't gotten to that degree of specificity.
And, one of the things we might consider is if there's a multi-year determination that gives us at least a guide, if not an absolute number, so that there's more predictability. Yes?
Gary, why roll out, the puck and player tracking in time for the playoffs? Why not just wait until game one of next season to
Why not? Why not? Unless you're trying to make an issue over something that's not an issue, there's no reason to hold it if it's ready.
Well,
the bigger issue for us was installing the technology in the buildings, which has nothing to do with the actual playing of the game.
Right, but that still hasn't been totally completed yet, right?
It's been completed, I believe.
26 out of 31?
Yeah, and that'll be done before the playoffs. So, not an issue.
Mr. Bettman, this just came in, but I'm not sure if you're aware of it or not, but the Senators have dismissed their new CEO for conduct inconsistent with the core values of the team. I'm just wondering if you knew about it, if you have any comment.
It's not what you think. Or would be suggested. It relates more to, I generally don't comment on club personnel decisions. It's not one of the things that we were discussing at the board meeting in December. It has to do more with internal operations. And if you want more, you need to talk to the senators about that.
Are you at all preoccupied, however, about the fact that it just seems to be, there's always something around the corner with the Ottawa Senators?
Eugene Melnick has been an owner in good standing for, 15 years at least, maybe 20. And teams sometimes go through cycles for a variety of reasons, but I am not one who overreacts or is concerned when a team's performance is less than the people of that community would like to see, but I know Eugene is passionate about the game, passionate about the team, and it wasn't that long ago that the team was, a game away from the Stanley Cup Final? I mean, in sports, it's really easy to criticize and second guess, and it's harder to do, and every now and then a team goes through that kind of cycle.
Gary, where are you guys over? What you'd mentioned after the Bill Peters episode that there was going to be sensitivity training and some programs rolling out after that. Where is any of that at?
So it's fairly well along. We hope to have our, for lack of a better term, whistleblower platform up and running by June 1st is our goal. And obviously, we are in the process of developing the education program, training program for club executives and coaching staff. And they will all be trained prior to the start of the season. We're trying to figure out delivery and timing of that, but it's prior to the start of the season.
Steve Ricardo told us yesterday that only the TV broadcasters will have a bucket player tracking that in the playoffs, and it'll be an evolving art. I'm kind of curious, is it completely up to the broadcasters how they use this data, and what do they want? How will that art evolve, I guess, and so for fans?
I think it's going to evolve. We saw it used All-Star Weekend, and I think part of it's going to be in terms of the storytelling, what they think works well, and I think some of it's going to rely on feedback that they get from the fans. Ultimately, in the long term, this may be a multi-screen experience. There may be something on traditional television, and then on a second screen stream, or third screen even, you may be able to isolate on certain things you're focused on, pick up data that you're interested in. This is an evolution in terms of perhaps personalizing the experience fans have in viewing a game.
My understanding is they overdid it on purpose in the All-Star game, especially on the second screen, obviously, because they want to play with it, right? See what
play with it, and I think they also wanted to test the capabilities.
Right. So, do you have any understanding of where they're going to start?
Well, my guess is they'll start slower and ramp up as they get more comfortable with it. But that's really a question addressed to them and the director's style in terms of how he thinks the game needs to be produced.
Not sure for Gary or for Bill, but just following whistleblower program. I think the last time we talked, you said there were a couple of things you guys were looking into. Have there been any more people reporting anything of concern? Is there any other sort of, are you looking at anything else since then?
What I'd say is that, you know, obviously since the commissioner laid out his four-point plan in Pebble Beach, I guess, you know, one of the elements or tenets of that is mandatory reporting of really everything. And I can tell you our clubs have been over-inclusive and the level of communication we're getting on issues that are going on that are really kind of local team issues has been good, solid, and, you know, so there's a whole host of things that go on at the club level. Normal HR issues that they deal with on a regular basis, and we've been brought into the loop on that because clubs want to err on the side of being over-inclusive. But no, and we're not sitting on major scandals or news-breaking stories in that regard.
Actually, I would only quibble with the word of over-inclusive. Very, very, very inclusive, and that's okay. I think communication has reached a higher level of sensitivity, and I think that's great. Because as I said, we don't like surprises.
Did you give any update on CBA talks and any progress in an international calendar? Or is anything you can give us on that?
Yes.
I think I've been publicly said
that we have re-engaged with the Players Association after a period of inactivity on the CBA front. We've had a number of meetings on various issues over the last 2 weeks. We each have kind of to-do lists in terms of getting back to each other, so the process has restarted. I would be too early for me to say that whether we're making progress or not making progress. It really has been a catch-up to where we left off, and then we'll see where we take it from here.
And to add to that in terms of your question, nothing would please us and the clubs more than to have long-term labor peace, and with that, the possibility of a long-term international calendar. So we remain hopeful and energized at the prospect.
Gary, did you have any, so the travel ban would mean that general managers can't go over to the World Championships if the World Championships?
Well, our league office travel ban. Okay, the clubs are still on their own in terms of deciding what to do. We were telling you what we've done at the league office with our employees, and the clubs are aware of what we've done, and at least for the time being, they're in a position to implement whatever policies they think are appropriate. Pierre?
Yes, there's a bit of discontent from some of the managers on the bi-week / all-star break situation, and I know that came up today. I also know that it's negotiated with the PA, which I'm sure you're reminded of today, but what can be done for it to maybe alleviate some of those concerns, especially in terms of the press schedule in February, March?
I think you got to the bottom. I think that, you know, it's not our invention.
It's not our preference.
It's something that the Players Association has asked for. And it's, you know, part and parcel of a broader agreement we have with them. So I told the managers it's not going anywhere anytime soon or at minimum for next season. What we can do and what we are trying to do is kind of mitigate any concerns with respect to how we schedule. And, you know, Steve Hatzepetros works very hard with very tough parameters to try to make the schedule as competitive and fair as it can possibly be. And from time to time, some clubs get on the kind of the wrong end of being able to get a schedule they want. So that's the nature of the beast. It's true with scheduling generally. And this is just another element of that.
The managers, I think, as a group, would prefer that the break go away. And we concur, particularly from the scheduling standpoint. But it is what it is, and that's something we have to reason together with the Players Association on. But that's what's in place
as Bill said, certainly for next year.
Okay.